Welcome to the IISS this morning. My name is Rahul Roy Chaudhary. I'm the Senior Fellow for South Asia at the Institute. As India's economy grows and trade relations deepen, the Navy finds itself at the forefront of India's widening diplomatic and strategic engagements. The safeguarding of energy shipments through the Persian Gulf is a key role for the Indian Navy. At the same time, India's naval profile is rising. The Indian Navy is the fifth or sixth largest in the world, with the IISS military balance listing its 36 principal combatants and over 100 other warships with nearly 60,000 personnel. The Indian Navy has been operating an aircraft carrier for over 50 years. The Navy's strength has increased and its capability recently bolstered with acquisition of a nuclear-powered attack submarine and the launch of a nuclear-armed submarine. At the end of this year, it will also commission a second aircraft carrier, with more to come. These developments reflect an evolution in India's policy towards a fast-moving political and security environment in the region, with the U.S. rebalancing its maritime forces towards the Asia-Pacific and China seeking greater access and reach into the Indian Ocean. But what does this all mean for India's maritime posture and maritime strategy? To reflect on these issues, we could not have a better or more knowledgeable speaker today. I'm delighted to welcome Admiral Nirmal Verma to the IISS this morning. Admiral Verma is the chairman of the Chiefs of Staff's Committee and the chief of the Indian Navy. Admiral Verma is one of the most intellectually orientated military chiefs in India. He has contributed greatly to the long-term development and strategy of the Indian Navy in his earlier posts as Assistant Chief of Naval Staff Policy and Plans and Vice Chief of Naval Staff, as well as playing a key role in the formulation of the Navy's recent doctrines. We are also delighted that Admiral Verma is able to address us at the start of his very busy three-day official visit to the UK. Admiral Verma.
Well, at the outset, I must say that not all that Rahul said as part of the introduction figures in the official biodata. Well, at the outset, ladies and gentlemen, let me say that it is such a delightful and distinguished pleasure to be here with you all. The reputation of the International Institute for Strategic Studies, or IISS, needs no elaboration. Suffice it to say that amongst other effects, your works cause sleep deprivation on a global scale. I know this personally, having spent many a night reading something that I could not put down. Thank you for your efforts to bring some clarity into our complex world. This complex world has been a creation of one certainty, and that is change. And consequently, the prevalent resultant can best be characterized as an uncertain environment. I would therefore not venture to suggest any predictions or prognosis for the future. Rather, I would like to share an Indian perspective on the metamorphosis of matters maritime. I would request your indulgence if I appear a shade nostalgic, since this is perhaps the last time that I address such an audience abroad in my capacity as the Chief of Indian Navy, since I will be swallowing the anchor soon. Consequently, I find myself often reflecting with much optimism about how we got where we are and how do we best address the challenges and opportunities that lie ahead. I will not be taking the dialogue back to Lothal of the Indus Valley civilization or the sinusoidal shifts of maritime inclination in the Indian mindset. Rather, I would specifically focus upon the past four out of the 6.5 decades of our independence that I have personally experienced while in uniform, wherein there has been a significant shift in maritime thought. Let me offer a few comparisons. When I first wore a uniform, we were a relatively young nation with the inheritance of an ancient civilization. The consequences of being vulnerable at sea were deeply etched in our collective national consciousness. There was a growing realization that the Indian Ocean was central to the well-being of India. Simultaneously, there was a void of sorts since the withdrawal of the British fleet east of the Suez, and as Robert Kaplan tells us, the Americans were barely aware of the Indian Ocean, concentrated as they were on the Atlantic and the Pacific, as is reflected by the mapping conventions which placed the Western Hemisphere in the middle, thereby splitting the Indian Ocean at the far edges. Today, the global gaze is focusing increasingly on the Asia-Pacific region, which underlines the significance of the Indian Ocean in global security affairs. Occasional reiteration of the term Indo-Pacific is a reflection of the rising preeminence of the Indian Ocean in global geostrategic considerations. In India, we recognize that 80% of the trade conducted across the Indian Ocean is extra-regional, besides, of course, the global concerns of energy security. Thus, the reality is that any adverse development in the region would affect the world economy. This translates to an appreciation of the need for cooperative engagement. The oft-reiterated Indian policy is that transnational peace and security must be regarded as global public goods which no state can assure by its efforts alone. This does not necessarily mitigate the competition among states in the region and beyond. In the early 1970s, we were indoctrinated with the harsh but relatively straightforward realities of the state-on-state conflict. Today, the global security environment is characterized by the changing nature of conflict, the predominant feature being that the challenges and their possible solutions are globalized in their character. Easy access to disruptive technologies, sophisticated arms, and distorted ideologies have resulted in the emergence of non-state, trans-state, as well as state-supported actors who are employing asymmetric means to damage political as well as social structures. Nanotechnology, robotics, biotechnology, nuclear proliferation, and cyber warfare may change the future warfare in unforeseen ways. We have had to recalibrate our responses accordingly. The second comparison that I would like to highlight is in the context of capability building, particularly shipbuilding. In 1972, Indian naval ship Nilgiri, the first Leander-class frigate built by Mazagon Docks, was commissioned into the Indian Navy. She was the first major warship to be built in India after a gap of over 100 years. Of course, a large major warship built in that yard was contemporary for those times. Today, we pride ourselves to be a builder's navy. This is a phrase that reflects the enormous investment that our Navy has made in conceptualizing ship and submarine designs. We have very vibrant indigenous construction programs, which I shall touch upon in a while. However, we still require to bridge certain technological gaps, and therefore the intention is to adopt leapfrogging technologies. This, I believe, is another area of possible global collaborations. The final quick comparison that I would highlight is the transformation of the Indian Navy from its previous avatar as the Cinderella service to the recognition that our Navy receives today. Pre-independent India had a significant army, but it really never had a Navy. The Royal Indian Marine had responsibilities virtually equal to that of a Coast Guard, since the maritime defense of India was the responsibility of the Commander-in-Chief Far East Fleet in Singapore. Post-independence, the wars on our land frontiers reinforced a continental mindset, and under the strain of successive fiscal crisis, the naval budget languished. Right until 1981, the Navy was constantly under 9% of the defense budget, and during time of crises, it was between 3 to 4%. This year, we crossed the 18% mark with the defense budget at US$36 billion. Though in my view this is still a shade short, the important takeaway is that there is an increasing realization that the destiny of our nation is entwined with our maritime destiny. Let me share with you a very honest and personal source of satisfaction as the Chief of the Naval Staff. A generation ago, the Chief of our Navy would have had to contend with the challenges posed by a national psych or sea blindness. Today, we are in gratitude of the efforts of our veteran community that we suffer no such impediment. The Government of India is completely seized of the imperative to have a credible maritime force that is commensurate to the requirements of our national interests, given the compulsions of budgetary boundaries. So if the comparisons that I have offered could be considered a narrative or the metamorphosis till now, our focus must shift to the priorities, challenges and opportunities prevalent and perceived to manifest in the future. Fundamentally for India, the priority for now and for the foreseeable future is to enhance the standard of living of a large number of our citizens. Our population must prove to be a national dividend and not a divide. This overriding priority is the goal that defines our internal and external security policies and explains why our defense budget as a percentage of our GDP is significantly below global norms. As a nation seeks to fulfill the legitimate aspirations of our people, as manifest by the prevalent pace of growth and development, the Indian Navy aims to ensure a secure maritime environment, which you would all appreciate is an essential ingredient for the safety of each individual citizen and our collective economic progress. Towards economic progress, our primary concern is the security of our sea lines of communication. By sheer volume and consequently value, marine transportation provides inherent advantages. The threats to our locks are multifarious. 41 years ago, when I joined the Navy, I would have never have stretched my imagination to anticipate that well into the 21st century, we would be collaborating with other navies to contain the centuries-old scourge of piracy. As piracy expanded eastwards, sometimes beyond 1,000 miles from the Horn of Africa and closer to our waters, shipping insurance companies extended the high-risk area closer to Indian waters. This naturally imposed a financial penalty on businesses using ships plying to the west coast of India, eating into their margins and resulting in higher operating costs. The Indian Navy has had a somewhat different and I dare say rather proactive approach towards combating piracy. There has consequently been a discernible shift in the ISLs as international shipping is now passing closer to Indian waters due to the protection provided by the Indian Navy and Coast Guard. Suffice it to say that our anti-piracy efforts have nearly eradicated piracy in our waters. Yet there remain associated dangers and challenges which require to be addressed. It may surprise some to know that our anti-piracy operations have thus far been coordinated trilaterally with the Chinese and the Japanese, and very recently this initiative has included the South Korean Navy. Such are the opportunities in the maritime environment. Energy security is a vital ingredient for economic progress, particularly for India, as energy is one of the largest constituents of our international trade. Our petroleum ministry has estimated that in 2009-10, we imported about 159 million tons of crude oil, which is expected to more than double to a figure of 364 million tons by 2025. The need to ensure unhindered flow of oil is becoming a major maritime consideration, not only for our country, but other nations as well. Providing energy security for the rapidly expanding global economy has led Indian firms to secure oil exploration and extraction rights right across the world. A variety of Indian companies have already secured rights in places like Sakhalin, Brazil, Colombia, Egypt, and Sudan. Another major imperative for our economic success and the security of individual citizens that has of late gained renewed focus is coastal security. In our external environment, one of our core concerns is the coalescing of the state with non-state entities. We might describe this hybrid as the state-sponsored non-state actor. On 26 November 2008, terrorists trained and equipped in Pakistan attacked iconic sites in Mumbai, killing 174 people. This was not the first instance that forces inimical to India exported terrorism via the sea. Coastal security will therefore remain an important issue in our overall maritime security. On the 3rd of April 1989, the Time magazine carried on its cover the caption, "Super India." The purport of this hyperbolic declaration was that the world had begun to take note of India as an emerging power. What warmed the cockles of the heart of every serving and retired naval officer then was the fact that the magazine's cover illustrated an imposing photograph of indigenous but hybrid Indian naval ship Godavari bristling with SSM launchers. We believed that we were truly poised to become a blue water navy. Now I'm often asked about the dichotomy of the fact that the Indian Navy, which professed blue water aspirations, is now engrossed in brown water operations. I see no such dichotomy in our maritime strategy as we discharge our responsibilities as the lead agency for coastal security. A multi-pronged approach that focuses on institutionalizing and enhancing the efficacy of multi-agency coordination, capability augmentation of various stakeholders, as well as setting up of adequate surveillance infrastructure that has been adopted. This is part of a strategy to address the changing nature of conflict that I had alluded you to earlier. At the other end of the spectrum is the necessity to sustain strategic deterrence. India is the only nuclear weapon state to announce an unequivocal no first use commitment and to declare that a world without nuclear weapons will enhance our collective security. In this backdrop, a retaliatory strike capability that is credible and invulnerable is an imperative. The Indian Navy is poised to complete the triad, and our maritime and nuclear doctrines would then be aligned to ensure that our nuclear insurance will come from the sea. There will naturally always be competitors for power, influence, and resources, with the goal of determining or affecting the behavior of other states and non-state actors. By the year 2025, three of the world's four largest economies will be in Asia. Many nations widely perceived to be rogue or failed states also belong to the same region. The region is also recognized by many as the primary loci of ostensible non-state threats in the world. Juxtaposed with these entities are three of the world's four largest armies and at least four declared nuclear weapon states, certainly not a dull neighborhood. At this juncture, it is important to make the point that the East is not a homogeneous entity. While Asia as a whole is growing, different nations are growing at different rates and in different ways, following in some cases quite different economic models. Each of these nations chooses to express the growing economic power differently. In some cases, it may lead to rapid military growth, non-compliance with the norms of international law, and the use or threat of the use of force. These are issues of concern. On our part, it is intended to ensure that the levels of asymmetry are never such that they encourage adventurism. The Indian Navy has adopted a capability-based rather than a threat-based approach for future growth. We have articulated a prospective plan that takes into account our maritime security issues and lays out a roadmap for development of capability up to 2027. I had mentioned about being a builder's navy. Our indigenous aircraft carrier project besides the ongoing construction of destroyers and frigates, light combat aircraft, navy, and strategic submarine programs are few examples. Of the 47 ships and submarines presently on order, 44 are from Indian shipyards. The indigenous aircraft carrier program is planned to be a continuing process over the next decade plus, with the Indian Navy's medium-term aim being to have at least 2 fully operational and combat-worthy carriers available at any given time. The induction program is structured to continue at a pace such that over the next 5 years, we expect to induct ships and submarines at an average rate of 5 platforms per year, provided the yards deliver as per contracted timelines. Our air element is also being strengthened with the induction of the MiG-29K fighters, the PATI maritime reconnaissance aircraft, as well as multi-role helicopters. I would now like to do a brief scan of our neighborhood. With respect to China, the facts are evident and well known. India and China are the 2 most populous nations on earth and are the 2 largest developing countries. Our societies and economies are amongst those that are transforming themselves rapidly. Both countries have managed to register reasonably healthy state rates of growth and maintain stability when most of the world was in economic turmoil. We share a common geopolitical space and similar socio-economic and energy security aspirations. China is India's largest trading partner. Yet none of these similarities can discount the fact that in the context of security, there exists a historic unresolved territorial dispute accentuated by concerns over each other's strategic partnerships. In addressing the complex political-military matrix in Pakistan, the comprehensive long-term perspective is certainly complicated. However, being next door, in India we require to deal with the practical and daily realities of infiltration, often facilitated by exchange of fire across the line of control. There have been marginal shades of progress since the dialogue process was resumed last year. There is an increasing realization of the considerable potential of bilateral economic and trade ties and the optimism of increasing people-to-people contact through liberalized visa agreements. However, the problems of terrorism and the lack of progress in bringing the perpetrators of Mumbai attacks to justice hinder the progress of bilateral relations. Talks on Siachen and Sir Creek boundary issues and the delineation of the international maritime boundary have at best only reiterated the intention to progress the dialogue through diplomatic channels. India and Bangladesh are bound by an historical legacy, culture, geography, which comprises a land border extending over 4,000 kilometers and a contiguous coastline that is unique on account of its deltaic nature. We have had significant progress in synergizing our efforts towards border management. In the context of naval cooperation, the hallmarks have been exchange of personnel for training, goodwill port calls by ships, and humanitarian assistance in the wake of cyclonic disasters. Sri Lanka has emerged after 3 decades of conflict with the LTTE. During this period, India fully supported Sri Lanka's stated objective of maintaining territorial integrity while emphasizing the need to accommodate the legitimate aspirations of the Tamil people. Subsequently, we have shared our concerns over the plight of internally displaced persons, for which we have contributed a robust program of assistance. Nearly half the training of Sri Lankan armed forces is carried out in India. In the maritime context, sale of an offshore patrol vessel and transfer on lease of another, assistance for the refits and restoration of Kankesan Turai Harbour have been the highlights, other than SLINX, which is the annual joint exercise between our navies. In Maldives, our prompt response to President Gayoom's appeal for help when mercenaries attacked Male in November 1988 has earned us the lasting goodwill of the Maldivian people. These bonds were reinforced by assistance rendered during the unfortunate tsunami of 2004. Today, the maritime cooperation between our nations ranges from support for training, transfer and maintenance of assets, hydrographic assistance, joint EEZ surveillance, and capacity building. We have similar exchanges with a number of other island and littoral nations in the Indian Ocean region. All these endeavors emerge from a perspective wherein we recognize that in our globalized world, both our security challenges and our best responses to them are global. In our view, this warrants both strategic autonomy and cooperative engagement. One obvious theme that comes under scrutiny when discussing Indian strategic thought is our emphasis on strategic autonomy. There is no reason to mistake autonomy for isolation, which is certainly not what we seek. It means engagement and an accompanying independence to pursue policy options that are best there to serve national interests. Strategic autonomy also does not mean that India will not shoulder her international responsibilities, nor does it preclude building strategic partnerships. The Indian Navy has been at the forefront of bilateral and multilateral cooperative engagements, and diplomacy is a critical component of a maritime strategy. Given our geographical position, our natural paradigm is to architect the stability of a region via our maritime routes. We are amongst the founding members of the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, or IONS, having hosted the inaugural conference in New Delhi in 2008. The third meeting of IONS recently concluded in Cape Town, South Africa, and we are of the view that IONS has been a very progressive step in increasing maritime cooperation amongst navies of the littoral states of the Indian Ocean region, thereby crystallizing the rhetoric of helping the IOR help itself. The Government of India recognizes the Indian Navy as an important instrument of our nation's foreign cooperation initiatives. Consequently, maritime diplomacy and cooperation form important aspects of our maritime strategy. Overseas deployments, staff talks, high-level visits, and major exercises at sea are being conducted regularly. Hydrographic surveys are a major enabler in this context. Our ships and aircraft have also been instrumental in conducting coordinated EEZ patrols for smaller nations, thus enhancing the overall security of the region as a whole. Post the 2004 tsunami and the evacuation of civilians from Lebanon in 2006 and Libya last year, capability building towards HADR operations has also received our focused attention. The growing scope and complexity of combined exercises, such as Malabar with the United States Navy, Varuna with the French, Konkan with the Royal Navy, Indira with the Russians, Simbex with Singaporeans, and Ipsa Mar with South African and Brazilian navies, all contribute towards our cooperative engagement initiatives. As I speak to you, some of our ships are on their way back from a deployment to South and East China Seas, while some others are on their way to the Mediterranean. In addition, we also contribute towards generating regional maritime capability through training exchanges and material support to the regional navies when requested. In 2011, 853 personnel from navies of friendly nations trained in India. This year, the numbers are intended to be increased. To summarize, I would say that strategic and conventional deterrence, capability accretion, and combat efficiency to deal with contingencies across the full spectrum of conflict and maritime cooperation constitute the cornerstones of a maritime strategy. We intend to keep our maritime strategy and policy options adaptive to the emerging environment. There are certain elements that are intrinsic, undeniable strengths, such as our peninsular geography astride the center of the Indian Ocean and our dispersed island territories. The innovative Indian spirit is another strength that I often reflect upon. We have seen it repeatedly and most intensely during the post-Pokhran sanctions. Last month, the aircraft carrier Virat in our Navy celebrated her 25th anniversary in the Navy. It is not unique for a ship to celebrate a silver jubilee, only that the ship in question is the ex-HMS Hermes that had already celebrated her 25th year while she was under the Royal Naval Ensign. So I do look forward to the innovative Indian spirit to navigate us through the many challenges that lie ahead and for the unknown unknowns that will certainly emerge in the future. With these words, I thank you for your attention and I'm now open to your opinions and any questions that there may be. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Admiral Verma, for the focus that you put on the Indian Navy's development capabilities and perspectives for the future. The session is now open for questions or comments. If you could catch my eye before you ask a question or make a comment, that would be useful. Let me begin by asking two questions of my own. Firstly, Admiral Verma, you talked clearly about the Indian government's realization of the importance of the Navy to both the security and diplomacy. At the IISS Shangri-La Dialogue in Singapore earlier this month, Defense Minister Antony also at the same time called for the unhindered freedom of navigation in international waters. Earlier, he had said the Indian Navy had been mandated to be a net security provider to island nations in the Indian Ocean. Following the 2008 Mumbai terror attacks, the Navy seemingly also has a counterterrorism mission. Recent doctrine of the Navy categorized for the first time the South China Sea as a secondary maritime area of interest. Do these developments, in effect, suggest a bolstered Indian naval posture or the making of a new maritime strategy that that you may have been elucidating? That's the first question. The second question is follows on a broader strategic level, and that is that, again, at the Shangri-La Dialogue, the U.S. Defense Secretary, Leo Panetta, this time, described how U.S. naval forces would rebalance towards the Asia-Pacific. Days later in New Delhi, Panetta said he saw defense cooperation with India as a linchpin in this new U.S. strategy. But India clearly is uncomfortable with such a role mandated to it possibly by the U.S. and responded formally by calling for the strengthening of the multilateral security architecture in the Asia-Pacific. But at the same time, China's growing military budget and projection of power in the Indian Ocean has raised concerns in India. The Indian Navy reportedly is shifting its forces from the west to the east, from the Arabian Sea Theater to the Bay of Bengal, even as it starts to seek, as you suggested, a military-to-military dialogue and contacts with China. As the Chief of the Indian Navy, how do you plan to navigate in relation to the American and Chinese naval forces in the Indian Ocean and the Asia-Pacific? Thank you.
Thank you, Raul. Well, the first question with respect to the bolstered Indian naval posture and whether it alludes to making of a new maritime strategy. Firstly, I'd like to say is that what the Honorable Defense Minister of India mentioned at Shangri-La Dialogue with respect to unhindered freedom of navigation is something which we have always stood for. So it was a reiteration of a policy that we have followed for decades. In fact, India is one of the first signatories of the UNCLOS in 1982, and we've always believed on the extraterritorial nature of the global commons, and in this particular case, the freedom of navigation and use of the seas. So to that extent, I'd say there was nothing new which had been mentioned. The second aspect which you talked about was with respect to being a net security provider. Now, in my view, I don't think maritime security is a zero-sum game. You know, it is something which, as I mentioned even during my talk, it works on a global scale. And as far as we are concerned, we've been a constant supporter of countries and navies in the region coming together. And so to that extent, where somebody has the ability or the capabilities, if it helps another nation to feel more secure, then I think it is just the right thing that needs to be done. And I would say that we've been doing it for a long period of time. I'd say at one point of time it was largely restricted to training exchanges, because with the type of force levels that we had and the capabilities that we had, that was one thing which was possible for us. But I'd say over the last decade or so, there has been a substantial accretion of assets as far as we're concerned. And this also has happened along with the growth of the new threats of piracy. And if you see the Indian Ocean region, we have nations which are very dependent on the tourism industry. And if you have some of these incidents close by, then certainly it would have a major impact on the economy. And like I said, we have a larger number of assets today. So if we are asked for help in terms of easy surveillance, then we like to help out, and that is what we've been doing. And this is totally in response to the requests that come to us. And whether it's, we have tried our best in terms of capacity building and providing assets in terms of patrol craft, etc., for which we also carry out the refits, because the refits are also something which costs money. Nations which are closer, we provide surveillance, air surveillance with aircraft taking off from our own mainland. Where you have a situation where the nation is further away from the mainland, we actually position assets over there. So as I see it, it is something that was ongoing. It's only that the complexity or the size of it has increased over a period of time. And our interest is basically a stable area, as well as unhindered use of the seas for slogs. And in any case, I'd say that maritime strategy is something which evolves, and over a period of time, there would be changes even as we are concerned, not necessarily steered by what the issues that you had raised, but new threats that emerge on the horizon. And this would certainly lead to a relook, like, for instance, coastal security being something new. I think I should have attended Shangri-La dialogue, because all the questions have emerged from there. The second issue is, of course, with respect to certain statements that were made by the U.S. Secretary of Defense over there. And you were asking me how would the Indian Navy navigate between the American and Chinese naval forces in the Indian Ocean and the Asia-Pacific. Now, since it's a navigational question, a navigational response would be to take all prudent precautions so that you don't have a collision. At the same time, I'd say that, having spent time in the U.S., as having undergone attended the Naval War College, I remember one of my professors telling me right in the early stages that you speak good English. I said, well, I think I go by. But one problem I have is with respect to American, understanding American. So if I have to go down to this, the word which seemed to have generated so much discussion, linchpin, and I look at the dictionary meaning of it, it says that it is something that holds a complex structure in place. And the maritime environment, I think, on the global scale, is something which is rather complex. And we all have to work together to ensure that there is stability in the areas that we're talking about. And I don't see there's any dichotomy or any conflict of interest in cooperating both with the United States Navy and working with China as far as ensuring stability of sea areas is concerned. With the U.S. Navy, as I mentioned, we've come a long way. We have a strategic partnership. There are regular meetings at the highest possible levels between our governments on the strategic issues that concern both of us. And similarly, as I had spoken in my address with respect to China, it's a major neighbor of ours in terms of the land boundary we share, our largest trade partner. And so to that extent, we have to actually find ways and means to work together. And I think this was, this is epitomized by the cooperation that is going on with respect to the anti-piracy patrols in the Gulf of Aden. And in fact, even now, over the last three years that I've been in the chair, any time there's been an incident of a Chinese merchant ship coming under the threat of piracy in our waters, which is closer to India, I think the first phone call is made to the Ministry of External Affairs in my country, and we are asked, and where we have the facilities or we have the platforms in place, we extend all possible assistance. More recently, we had a visit of the Chinese defense minister to our country. We had actually talked about maritime cooperation, and the two governments had agreed to find ways and means to have ministerial level dialogue on this. And I think this is also another step which is important for growing powers, for major powers who operate in the same areas. Even if one goes back and looks at the Cold War, at the peak of it, you still had both the blocs talking to each other with respect to incidents at sea agreement and the like, because the maritime domain is such that you need to understand each other so that there are no misperceptions of things that may happen at sea. And this is best, I would say, sorted out with dialogue. So as I see, there is no conflict, and I'm sure that we will find ways and means to work together to ensure with the common aim that we have peace and stability in the areas that we are talking about. The nature of cooperation that would be there within the maritime sphere with China, well, time will tell us, but like I said, at this point of time, it is restricted to fighting piracy in the Gulf of Aden.
Thank you. We have several questions ahead of us, so let me take two at a time. The first, Christian Lemaire, the IISS Research Fellow for Maritime Security and Naval Affairs. Christian.
Thank you, Admiral, for a very comprehensive presentation. My question is about Pakistan, which recently announced a sea-based nuclear deterrent, but it was a very vague statement. I wonder whether you could elaborate on India's view of what that sea-based nuclear deterrent might be, and how that would affect India's naval and nuclear strategy.
Could I turn to Professor Eric Grove, Professor at Salford University and a leading expert on maritime affairs in the UK.
Yes, Admiral, very, very nice to see you here, and thank you very much for your presentation. You mentioned how you're having to pay a lot more attention to, as you say, brown water coastal type of operations. Obviously, that's become clear after the Mumbai attack. And, of course, this perhaps creates challenges as to the balance of the fleet between more patrol-type vessels, and it means you have to make choices between numbers and capability, perhaps. This is something that's been discussed a lot very recently in Britain, where there have been ideas that perhaps we should have larger numbers of less capable vessels rather than in the new frigate program, for example, still continuing to produce first-class ships. And I just wondered what the Indian approach to this difficult problem of balance is between quantity and quality, basically, between less capable vessels, if you need those for numbers for the patrol role, against the need to operate at the very high end.
Well, the first question with respect to this, the sea-based nuclear deterrent, as far as Pakistan is concerned, I also read in the media about the inauguration of this command by the Chief of Naval Staff, Pakistan Navy. As far as we are concerned, as I mentioned, our policy is no first use, which requires us to have a deterrent which is able to retaliate in full measure and is capable of carrying out a strike, that is, after, say, somebody has used nuclear weapons. In today's world, actually, such situations also seem quite out of place. So as far as we are concerned, actually, nothing has changed. We have believed in a triad. Two arms of the triad are already in place, which is, the land-based missiles and the aviation vector. And I'm sure that in some months from now, and definitely by next year, we would have put in place the third element of the triad, The submarine was launched some time back, and it's now in the process of various trials. So in terms of what changes would come about in our case, I would say none. But I hope that such a situation never has develops as far as the world is concerned. With respect to the second question on brown water ops, I was briefly touched upon it in my talk. Professor, what I'd like to say is that the Navy came into it more as a coordinating agency, because till now, the large number of players in the maritime domain, there was no single headmaster who brought them under one roof to discuss and chalk out strategies that need to be done. And we found that if a structure has to be put in place, then the Indian Navy was best equipped to put it in place. And in fact, what we have done is largely to define the new organizational structures that should be in place. We have done a lot with respect to the technical means that should be put in place, which were absent in our country because of maybe problems of funding in the past. I'm talking about AIS chains, the coastal radar network, biometric identity cards for the complete fishing community, which goes into millions, and the like. And I'm happy to say that all these technical means are being put in place whilst the organizational changes were put in place earlier. With respect to the force mix that you're talking about or queried, I'd say it's not really changed as far as the Indian Navy is concerned, because really speaking, this task is that of the Coast Guard, which unfortunately also suffered from lack of funds and were not able to have the type of accretion of assets that were required at that point of time, I mean, over the last decade. And today, in fact, the Coast Guard is also on a major growth path. And as I see that the type of platforms that are required would actually be, are coming up in the inventory of the Coast Guard. We have not made any substantial changes at all as far as our future plans are concerned. You know, we have created a marine police which was non-existent in the past. So these are the new platforms which are coming, not owned by the Navy, but certainly carrying out the task of coastal security.
The next two, if I can ask the gentleman there. Yes, please.
Admiral, thank you very much for your talk. Given the operating conditions of the Indian Ocean
region... Could you identify yourself?
Sorry, my name is Alan Rose. Yeah. Given the operating conditions of the Indian Ocean region, would Indian interests, such as securing the sea lines of communication, etc., of the region, not be better served through maintaining a fleet of advanced AIP SSK submarines rather than the expensive SSN option? Or is this SSN capability purely intended as a counter to China's growth in the region?
Could I now turn to my colleague, Brigadier Ben Barry, the Senior Fellow for Land Warfare at the Institute.
Admiral, if I may, a couple of questions on piracy. India has a reputation for being much more robust than many other naval contingents. Is this the case? And if so, how is it are you able to be more robust? Is it simpler and more robust laws? And I was also struck by your remark about maritime coordination, that until the Navy took the lead, there was no overall headmaster tying it together. Do you think the same thing actually applies to the international counter-piracy effort with three independent multinational operations and then the national operations by yourself, the Chinese and the Russians?
Well, the first question with respect to submarines with AIP in lieu of nuclear submarines, I think that one doesn't compare with the other. They're two entirely different tasks that they have to perform. And if you look at the capabilities that are required, the AIP is no substitute for a nuclear attack submarine. Now, if you see worldwide where nuclear submarines have been developed by navies, they've gone through a phase where they first developed the nuclear attack submarine, optimized it, and then graduated to the SSBN. In our case, I guess because the program itself took quite some time, in fact, the first submarine that is being built by us is actually SSBN. So to that extent, I would say for a country of our size and the type of tasks that we see before us, this was a gap which was there and which certainly is something which needs to be addressed. The AIP submarines, they have their own role to play, I mean, in littoral waters. And the next line of submarines that would be inducted by the Navy would be AIP capable. And as I see, there is a requirement for a nation of our size, the type of maritime responsibilities that we see for ourselves, our maritime interests, both these arms as far as submarines are concerned are required. The second question with respect to the robust action which is taken has been taken by the Indian Navy and has in fact helped eradicate piracy from our waters, because with all the efforts going on off the coast of Somalia, some of this was some piracy attempts had happened, say 200 miles from the island territories that we have on the west coast. That would put them out 500 miles from our coastline. By and large, you would see, till the best maintenance practices, now where they are with terms of armed guards and citadels on ships, at that point of time, there were chances of a ship getting hijacked. And what we found was, by and large, when this happened, and if a hijacking attempt failed, then, the concerned navies or the ships there would take a sigh of relief and get on with the job. In our case, in these waters, closer to our coast, if there was a failed attempt of hijacking, that became the start point for a major operation from our side in terms of deployment of the surface ships, of aircraft, in large numbers, because the intention was to locate the mothership. And I must say that each of the instances that happened, we were tracking all motherships in the Arabian Sea, and we were able to narrow down to areas where a possible mothership could be, and that's the reason there are some 120 pirates now in the jails in India, and due legal process is being followed for prosecuting them. I wish the nations which are deploying ships in the Gulf of Aden could actually come to a common strategy. Unfortunately, what is happening is that navies like the Indian Navy, along with the Japanese, the Chinese, the Russians, the Malaysians, the Koreans, and a few others, we believe that the way to escort ships in the Gulf of Aden is through the convoy system. When we were just alone, as a single ship, we would revisit a spot once in 4 days. Now with three navies, and if South Korean Navy also finalizes this, by this coordination, there would be a ship at the same spot once a day. If you count the number of ships which are being put to sea by Task Force 151 of Atlanta, you find that they follow a different concept of dividing this internationally recognized transit corridors into certain patrol areas. And based on the movement of ships, they put certain warships in certain patrol areas. But in terms of numbers, I think they're devoting at least 4 to 8 ships. Now, if we all do the convoy system, which is what we've been suggesting, you would have a convoy moving every 12 hours and maybe even at lesser frequency. And I'm sure that much maybe the ships that desire escort would be able to make use of. But nonetheless, we at least on other areas, we talk to the navies under the shared mechanism, as also under the aegis of UN, you have the contact group on piracy. But I wish everybody could come on board the convoying system.
Let me just push you a bit further on what you've just said, Admiral, in terms of seeking to carve out a common strategy on the Gulf in terms of a convoy system. There have been some questions relating to the Indian Navy, to a large extent, going about it alone, notwithstanding the coordination now with China, Japan since January this year, and most recently, as you mentioned, with South Korea. But would a move towards such a convoy system bring on board a more sort of coordinated, a more cooperative Indian naval presence? Or would the Indian Navy still feel that in the absence of certain other conditions, primarily, I suppose, under a UN aegis that the Indian Navy would not be able to coordinate as effectively still with other ships, even if it were a convoy system.
You see, anything substantive with regard to tackling piracy, certainly we prefer that it is UN mandated. But as far as coordination of anti-piracy operations in the Gulf is concerned, there is no such requirement. We're talking about coordination. The very fact that there are three navies which are doing it today, which is the Chinese, the Japanese, and us, and the South Koreans are coming on board because they also find merit in it, there would be no issue because it's a question of the lead navy promulgating its escort schedule, and in alphabetical order, everybody else down the line does it. And that sort of a coordination, I find no problem whatsoever in doing things the way they're already happening with a larger number of navies participating.
Sure. Unfortunately, we have only time for the last two questions because the Admiral needs to go to the next engagement. But let me ask my colleague, Antoine Levac, and then there's a gentleman at the end there. Yes.
Sir, thank you. You used the word leapfrogging in your address. I was wondering if you could maybe describe in more detail what that might entail for domestic industrial capability production and what also it could entail in terms of actual programs of equipment underway. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Gordon Wilson, a fellow Royal United Service Institute, a member here and a former naval person. Admiral, thank you very much for that. I want to ask more to elaborate on a comment you made in your talk about your wanting to have more cooperation with the navies of East Asia. You specifically mentioned Japan, China, and South Korea. How do you envision them operating with you in what is your territory direct interest in the Indian Ocean? And that is apart from the operations you do with anti-piracy activities. And what are your strategic aims in further east, in the China Sea areas and beyond in the Pacific, particularly how you interpret the Chinese approach to having total territorial claims to all the areas around the Spratly and Paracel Islands?
Well, the first question with respect to leapfrogging technologies. There has been, I would say historically, India always wanted to be a self-reliant nation in all respects, but you found that in this process, very often we might have been in a catch-up situation. I'd say with passage of time and the fact that there is large convergence of interests in matters of security across the world, we find that this is an opportunity where we can collaborate in certain areas where niche technologies are involved. And to that extent, I'd say that our defense procurement procedure has also been modified, where I'm just going to give a term, don't translate it literally. It's a category called buy and make Indian, where Indian companies which are, which have the apparent wherewithal, they may not be making a particular product which the armed forces are keen on, are permitted to tie up with any company that they want abroad, from abroad. But from our perspective, what is required is at the end of it, there has to be a product which meets our specifications completely. And the fact that this contract has to be ironclad so that we don't have a splitting of ways between the Indian partner and the foreign partner at some point of time. And giving examples, because it's all on the MOD website, today, for instance, we are looking for a surface surveillance radar. And to cut short development schedules, we put it, because we have a very vibrant private sector who's been saying that their capabilities are not being utilized, so we picked up certain companies, we had given them a concept definition document. They collaborate with their respective partners, come back with a detailed project report. If it meets our requirements, then they're allowed to bid, and the lowest bidder will get the contract for it. Similarly, the landing platform dock program for us, I'm talking with respect to ship constructions, we are following a similar formula where the shipyards, both in the government sector and private, are allowed to tie up with capable companies abroad. And the same process, concept definition document from our side, a detailed project report from their side, a bidding process, and building of the product. The other question, if I've got it right, talked about the cooperation that is already taking place with respect to China, Korea, etc. on one hand, which is for a specific task as far as anti-piracy is concerned, and the fact that how else are we cooperating with Southeast Asian nations? I think that was a query. Well, I'd say that, if you take some of the nations which are closer to us, in fact, if you look at the Andaman Islands, which are on the eastern seaboard of India, they are much closer to Indonesia than they are to the Indian mainland. But with countries like Thailand and Indonesia, we have coordinated patrols. It's a great opportunity for ships, young teams of officers and sailors to work together and create elements of interoperability so that if we ever have to work together for a situation, then I'd say there's so much greater understanding. With Indonesia and Thailand, you have the pattern is before the patrolling starts, there is a briefing at one of the countries, whether it is Indonesia or India, Port Blair that is, and the closing ceremony is in another one. And it's come a long way, and there's a great deal of comfort. In fact, from being an annual event, it has already been made twice a year. And as I see in the coming years, when both sides have more platforms, we would do this. We're also going to build in exercises as part of this coordinated patrol. So we are trying to work together as best as possible. I'd also say that I touched upon IONS. That's another area, the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, where we've been working with all the IOR littorals, including nations from Southeast Asia. Was there something else?
That was. Excellent. I know I've disappointed several of you who've raised your hands and who wanted to ask a question or make a comment, but time is short. We have to move on, and the Admiral has to go to the next appointment. So I would be grateful if all of you could remain in your seats while the Admiral and his delegation leaves for the next appointment. But before I go a bit goodbye, I'd like to thank you, sir, for coming here on the first day of your official visit. And my own sense and my own takeaway on this is that if it's not a new maritime strategy for India, it's definitely a dynamic maritime strategy that we're looking at. And there are key developments to follow, and interest clearly growing in the Indian Navy as it takes on greater roles and responsibilities in the Asia Pacific. So with that, I'd like to thank you very much for being here, and hope all of you can join me in thanking the Admiral. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you very much.